In 1942, the German and Italian armies had control of most of the Mediterranean coastline of North Africa. The German general Field Marshal Rommel aimed to capture Cairo and control the Suez Canal, thus preventing its use by Britain and her allies. Australian troops delayed the German advance by refusing to surrender to Brooke. Meanwhile, the commander of British troops and the Australian, New Zealand and Indian allies built up a formidable and well-supplied force at El Alamein. The battle cost thousands of lives. The British eventually won. This was the first significant defeat of the Germans in World War II. German and Italian troops were forced to retreat and were finally driven out of North Africa altogether. An Allied invasion from the west, led by the American general Dwight Eisenhower, was a practice run for the later invasion of German-occupied Europe. Imagine tens of thousands of troops in fierce battle with nowhere to shelter from the constant bombardment and machine gun fire in this flat and featureless Sahara Desert. The White Obelisk is an Australian memorial and carries the Rising Sun hat badge of the Australian soldier. Gravestones shown are part of the Australian section of the cemetery. One individual stone is for the unknown soldier, and the other is of a Sergeant Bell from Western Australia. The trees are similar to trees common in Western Australia. The cemeteries and memorials are being gradually encroached on by development. Security is tight in Egypt, with armed security people everywhere. There is also a security person on each tourist bus. Our bus was stopped partway to El Alamein, with papers and driver checked by a posse of security people. 12 tourists were still in the custody of kidnappers in one of the southern tourist destinations. The war museum in the locality of the various cemetery memorials is extraordinarily interesting to anybody wanting to have understanding of what the El Alamein battle would have been like. Outside and inside, the exhibits are well cared for and set out to great advantage. The Spitfire aircraft was one of the glamour aeroplanes of the Second World War. When the first Spitfires appeared over Perth, later models than the one shown, West Australians knew that the war was going in the right direction. A British ex-service man on the tour commented on the straight-barrelled howitzer, a German anti-aircraft weapon which Rommel discovered to be an excellent anti-tank gun. When I showed the picture to a friend who'd been at the Battle of El Alamein, he was obviously affected. He said that gun was so damaging to the British tanks that it almost cost them the victory. The Mediterranean Sea was the backdrop to all the battles across North Africa. There is an electronically controlled representation of the battle area and its surrounds. The eagle is an Italian symbol, and the wall of photos is part of the Italian section of the museum. The painting is very graphic in depicting the deadly nature of the battle in open flat surrounds. Rommel and Montgomery's busts depict the two opposing generals. Development right alongside the museum is the outer edge of similar building that stretches all the way from Alexandria, the nearest large city, about 2 hours' drive away in modern vehicles. In 1942, none of this development was there, only the Sahara Desert. All the magnificent homes we were told are holiday apartments, not occupied except during the holiday season. And mostly, there was no sign of occupation. Nearby are the German and the outermost Italian cemetery memorials, both quite different from the Commonwealth War Graves Commission cemeteries, which are much the same all over the world. The German memorial is hexagonal and fully enclosed. There are sarcophagi all around with the names of the dead on plaques above them. A story about the Italian memorial, which also has its distinctive style, is that an Italian soldier managed to escape from the battle and hide for weeks, eventually finding his way back to Italy. After the war, he was determined to commemorate his lost comrades and set about raising the funds, including the selling off of his own assets. At the end, looking inland away from the Mediterranean Sea, the traveller is reminded that the thousands of men, all a long way from their homelands, fought one another at the cost of thousands of their lives in an empty, flat, windswept, sandy desert.